for you this experience in terms of Planet of Apes? Because are there challenges, special challenges for this role? I mean, it's more expressive than, I mean, Kong or Gollum. How was for you this sort of thing? And there is another thing that I'd like to know. It's this inversion of humanity that the film, that the movie shows in a very strong way. And this third sequel is the best one. Congratulations.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much. I mean, the whole metaphor of using apes to say something about the human condition obviously started with the original 1968 version, and it's a very powerful metaphor because, of course, apes are 97% genetically the same as us, and yet they look so different. So to be able to see human emotion evolving really allows us to put a mirror up to ourselves and to see, you know, to see our flaws, to see what in humanity, where it's going wrong. Mm-hmm. So in terms of the challenges, Caesar, people think, some people just say to me, you know, so you had to obviously study being an ape, you had to copy ape movements and so on. I mean, that is just the very basic place to start, because it's not really about that. Unlike King Kong, who was who I played as a full-on silverback gorilla, but these are apes who are evolving, and Caesar evolves hugely over the course of the three films and changes. And so my approach was the challenges, and my approach was to find to base him in a real ape character, but also his personality. What is his personality? And it was very much that he was a human in ape's skin. He was brought up with human beings, and therefore has a particular outlook and understanding and empathy for human beings, as well as apes. Mm-hmm. As he grows and changes from being an infant all the way through his life, which I've been able to play, he goes through these changes and is able to. We see him not only change from a young chimpanzee to a revolutionary leader, to a creator of a movement, to a leader in time of war. We also see him evolve and become more upright and think more like a human being and more emotionally like a human being. So the challenge was, throughout all of these movies, was to make him believable, to see that his thought processes were changing, that emotionally he was becoming more human-like, and make him sound when he was using language, for instance, in this last movie, that it's still believable that an ape could speak without it sounding too human.
Who is Child?
I don't know.
But she was you.
She has no one else.
Mm-hmm. There is a sort of education in terms of education, psychological education for Caesar.
Exactly.
I mean, he learned how to behave as a, not a human being, but a very special being.
Exactly.
That's it.
Exactly that, yeah.
And you developed a sort of acting art during your career, and I'd like to know how did you develop this art, because it's very special. I mean, acting capture, we call it action capture.
How was for you this can be a
sort of a grand art of acting in the future, in the near future, because you are one of the responsible for this sort of a very special thing in terms of acting in the cinema, in the games as well.
I think it's really important to understand, in fact, that the acting process is no different to any form of characterization in live action movies, or, you know, it's not. I don't think it's a special form of acting. I really don't. I think that is crucial to understand, because the process of building a character is the same. For instance, you know, if I was playing a doctor, I would have to research what a doctor does, how he lives his life, you know, what his speciality is, if he's a brain surgeon or if he's a, you know, you'd have to study all of those things. And if I'm playing an ape, I have to study all of those things about being an ape. But crucially, the difference of the emotion of the character, you know, who is this doctor? Where, you know, what's his backstory? What's his personal life like? You know, how is he emotionally? Is he very uptight? Is he sad? Is he, you know, it's the same process. You don't have to, when actors ask me, you know, is this a special type of acting? I say, no, it's just creating a character. I have to know everything. But I suppose these characters are more extreme, so you're still having to find the human connection to Caesar or to Gollum or to King Kong. It is the human connection to those roles, but that's what we do. We use our imaginations to become other people or beings.
Years from now, your children will ask you, what did you do in the greatest war? And you can tell them, I fought to protect this world. And I'm the world's forgotten boy. We created them. But now, we will bring an end to their kind.
Because there is the body expression, very radical because it's an animal.
Sure.
And the voice expression is different as well.
Sure, sure, that's true. But that's, you know, if I was playing, someone who had Tourette's or someone who, you know, someone had an extreme physical condition, then you have to, again, it's about studying that behavior. It's studying behavior.
And how about Gollum, for instance, the Smeagol?
Yes.
Because it's a work of imagination, it's an art of
sure.
acting imagination.
Sure.
So how did you create
Gollum? Well, my starting point for Gollum was really finding out what his the ring means to Gollum. So for me, again, bring it back to the human, it's for me, the ring was all about addiction. The notion of addiction and the schizophrenia that comes about from if you're a heroin addict or you're driven by a craven lust for something which is completely obsessing you. So it's, again, it's always finding the human connection to even the most extreme character.
Mm-hmm. And you continue to act like a normal actor. Doing Van Gogh and
yes,
and this sort
absolutely.
Of Einstein. How was for you to? How do you compare this? Is not you think you said that's the same thing, but I mean it improve. You have to improve another sort of techniques.
Sure. I mean, these are different characters in different stories, and so it's all about subsuming your self into those characters. But I mean, that is what an actor does. I think it's what is interesting is that people are very focused on the technology, and that they think that the technology affects the acting performance, which it doesn't at all. It doesn't, because it's no different to putting on a costume and makeup than putting on a motion capture suit with a head-mounted camera. It's what you wear to create the character. So I think it's really important for people to realize that acting is acting.
Even on stage or in a film, it's the same thing.
Yes, it's all the same. I wouldn't, if I was playing a character on stage in the theater, the creation of the character is exactly the same. Obviously, you're slightly modifying for theater your projection because you've got to reach people at the back of, you know, at the back of the house. But in terms of becoming the character, it's not
the same. And you are beginning to direct movies. How is the experience for you?
I love it. I mean, I'm really enjoying the process, and it started a long time ago. My desire to direct. I started to make short films and then directed performance capture and video games, and then Peter Jackson asked me to direct the second unit on the Hobbit trilogy, which was a huge education. And then I started working on Jungle Book and Breathe, which is the film that is coming out later this year. in October at the Toronto Film Festival.
And you are a sort of a director of directors,
yes.
Probably, because you are so
yes,
very amazing much so. Actor.
Yeah,
so you like to direct.
I love working with actors and shaping, helping to shape performances within the story as a whole. But I also have a very I'm a very visual director too, in the sense that I have an aesthetic. Before I became an actor, I studied art and visual arts and photography.
This is our last stand. And if we lose, it will be a planet of apes.